I will talk to you about Pharo. So this is me. So basically, I am a researcher in language design. And from that perspective, I did, you see, traits, which are now in, they're not the same. When people said that traits are in Scala, this is a different flavor. So, but the ones that are in PHP or in Perl, they are somehow influenced by the original ones. And I work on two topics. So one, this is language design. And the other one, this is how do we maintain large legacy application, banking, COBOL, you know, Java, all these large legacy systems. So what we do in my team is that we build tools or to be able to build visualization, understand impact analysis, metrics, quality, meta modeling, and all these kinds of things on large legacy systems. And I created a company that sell tools based on that. So, yes. I also did my PhD in Lisp long time ago in Silos. So I was a meta object protocol fan. I'm still. So I did it in Lisp and Scheme, and I wrote Lisp interpreter and all this stuff. And now I will talk to you about Pharo, because for me, Pharo, at the end, this is when I think about object-oriented programming, and I like the quote of Alan Kay that he said, when I thought about object-oriented programming, I didn't thought about C++. Me neither. So for me, when I discovered Smalltalk, it was like, wow, that's a Lisp with object. Or this is an object language with Lambda expression the way I like them. So that's why I said, okay, it has been designed for me because I like object and I like functional programming. So this is, so what we have is that Pharo, this is an open source implementation, and I will explain you what is it, because the goal is not to redo the past, because we don't want to live in a museum. And this is the companies that are participating to a consortium to fund some engineers to develop Pharo. So basically, I can do some marketing about Pharo. After, I want to get you some feel. I will show you the model and the syntax. So that's easy. This is one slide. So you see, so like that. The model is four slides. So after, we can code together if you want. I could show you a bit some web dev with Pharo, and also ongoing works, what we are doing right now, and answer your questions. So after, we can speed or slow down, depending if you want. So what is Pharo? So Pharo, and you see, I don't cite Smalltalk, because Pharo is a Smalltalk-inspired environment, but our goal, this is not to reproduce Smalltalk. We don't care. It's cool, we like it, but we want more or less. So it's a pure object-oriented language. This is a great community of people doing all kinds of things. I will try to show you a bit. What I like is that you have the full access. You can go down to the virtual machine. The virtual machine is written in a subset of Smalltalk. It generates C code, and you have the complete stack. And all this stack is MIT. For me, I have fun. So this means that this is an important part of my life, so I pay attention to have fun. And elegant in the sense that I like the idea that the syntax fit on a postcard and that the model does not require me to kill a lot of brain cells to understand it. You know, I have something else to do in my life than... Well, I wanted to have a t-shirt, but do you know The Prisoner? No, this is an English series. The guy said, I'm not a number, I'm a human. I'm not a compiler, I'm a human. You know, that's the same. So for me, that fits well my philosophy. It's a living system, and I want to show you what I mean by living system. So this is MIT 100% inside. It runs on Mac, Linuxes, Windows, because this is the mess, come on. And iOS, and there is one version for Android that is under development, or I don't know if it was released or not. What I want, I have several videos. This is a student that is... that made a joke. So this is a student that used the metaphor of a city, a 3D city, to represent packages, class, methods, and things like that. And he did this video where on this side he has the code that is rendered there. And I like that he can do it on the fly. So each time he recompiles the method, it will change the system. And what you should see is that that could be a web page, a socket, whatever. We don't care. Because in our world, everything is an object. This is active, so we can interact with it the same way. I have some other video. I have some other video after. I will show you. Stop. Okay. So how do we see Pharo? What we see is that for us, this is this engine where we want to reinvent the future. You know, Alan Kay said the best way to predict the future, this is to invent it. And we said, okay, we don't like. So can we have a system where we can rethink the decision that were taken? So, and what you should understand is that Pharo is what we have, and this is not what we dream about. I mean, if I take this metaphor, we could be in Amsterdam, all together in a bus, in a double bus, in English bus. And when I arrive to Barcelona, it should fly, it should be a jet. And my dream is this is the jet, but right now I have a bus. But we are, every day we are making sure that we improve the system. And we will do it. It's just a question of time. So in Pharo, you have all kinds of projects. I will not list them, you know. You have assembly generation. We can generate assembly on the fly and blah, blah, blah. Visualization, XHTML, blah, 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 blah. And plenty more. In fact, we have a problem because now we have too many of them, so we don't know exactly what is happening. So we are working on a catalog because this is the mess. So to find information now, it starts to be, or luckily there is Google, but we want to have something a bit better structured. So what is our goal, in fact? Because as a researcher, I could just write papers that nobody reads, and my life would be okay. So I'm not satisfied by that, because for me, I'm a researcher that believes that we should have an impact. And it's okay to write papers. Sometimes, what you should pay attention to, when you read papers about researcher, sometimes we write papers because we did an experiment, we are not really satisfied, but we claim that we are satisfied so that the other researcher can accept it, because they don't accept negative results. So, you know, it's sad. But it does not mean that because it has been published that we believe in it. For me, this is just a milestone. I said, okay, this is what we wrote about what we understood at that time, and now I don't like it. So there are a lot of papers I wrote that I don't like. But so to come back to the point, so what we are doing with Pharo, this is not just a small talk. We want to build an ecosystem, and an ecosystem where there is innovation and business. And for example, what's happened with Seaside, with the way of developing website some years ago, this is a typical case of innovation for me. So what do I mean? I mean that we want that you can make money with Pharo. That's a principle one, because this is important. I think that if people make money, then this is a proof that this is somehow useful. And yes, that people can invent, because we are not the only one to be smart. So we want that people get good tools to invent what they want. So that's why there is a lot of work that we are doing in Pharo that people don't see, because usually when you take Pharo, you see the top of the iceberg and said, oh yes, there is this menu. But we are working in the infrastructure. So for example, last year we rewrote completely the compiler. Now we will have first class variable. We can do a lot of nice stuff with that. So some students already introduce reactive programming in some part of their user interface just because they could reuse our first class instance variable. And for us, we said, yes, they got it, because what we want to work on the how we can enable other people to do things. So what is the community behind Pharo? This is just for the marketing, so we don't care. So there are something like 23, 24 university in the world teaching Pharo. And for example, in Argentina, I know some places where they have 500 students. So it's growing. This is the source forge that we have. So not all the users are real, because sometimes you have students that log once and never show up again. But this is where the community, we have three forge like that. And you have the people that commit on GitHub without committing to this forge. So this is the historical forge. And we have three other, two other like that, where people publish their code. So we have a couple of research groups, because for us, we really want that researcher can play also, can also play the game. And a bunch of companies. Sometimes I don't know what they are doing with that. Sometimes they disappear, sometimes. You see, for example, the last time I found, this is this Japanese company, and I found it by accident because I saw that on their webpage they have a Pharo in their carousel. But they don't speak English, so it's a bit difficult. Part of the community is that we pay attention to produce books. So we have one book that is called Pharo by Example, which is really to get started. And it has been translated to French, Spanish, Japanese. It is available. We are updating it because this is on the first version of Pharo, so this is a bit dated now. Most of the things works, but we have one that is called Deep into Pharo, where we can go really into the implementation of closure, for example, is really nice, and the exception also, because the exception model in Pharo are really cool. So there is a, there was a new book on numerical methods. This is 400 pages of, most of the time, a lot of maths. And we have several books in preparation, one that is updated Pharo by example. This is already one that is describing the web stack. This is what are all the web frameworks or the web library that are available, and one that is fun with Pharo. This is the one that I want to work on. So I just want to show you, I will go fast. I don't really care what they are doing. I care that they are doing it. So this is just to give you a feel of what the people are doing with Pharo, because sometimes I never met them. So this is a content management system. It was done some years ago where we could change everything on the screen. This is a scheduling system, distributed scheduling system to manage events, so they, it's quite complex, and they generate SVG, and they can allocate rooms and people and microphones and I don't know what, and you know, the calendar, and multiple people can work on the same time and things like that. So this one I don't know, but what is interesting is the stack. So Zinc is a HTTP server. C-side, this is a dynamic web application server. They use jQuery. Magritte, this is a meta modeling system. So basically, you describe your class and automatically generate web component for you. Fuel, this is a binary serializer that is quite fast. MongoTalk, this is a subset on top of Mongo to be able to do query that are a bit nicer. So this is a company that is doing, the UI is done in HTML. And then all the server backend are done in Pharo, so I don't know what they do. Yes, they have all the rest backend is done in Pharo. This is a solution where people can do a visit card on the web and print them directly. Yes, this one was a bit special because this is a mixture between Pharo and Ember. So Ember, this is a small talk that is running natively in JavaScript. And this was a system to monitor people when they do simulation, catastrophe simulation. I don't know more. Ibislog, now this is a bit old, but this is, or this was a meta shop. So this means that you want to sell your whatever that you did in your garden or in your garage, you want to sell that on internet, you go to Ibislog and then you create a shop. In 10 minutes, you have your shop and you could sell stuff. It was done in, what was interesting in Ibislog, it was developed in 5 months from scratch. And when you see the complexity, we said, okay, by one person. Dr. Geo, this is nothing to do with the rest. This is a geometrical system for kids, where they can build geometry by interactively, and he deployed that on all kinds of platforms. So Moose, this is an analysis platform that we developed. So on top of which we build a visualization and things like that. So this is a object profile. This is a company in Chile that is doing visualization with Pharo, and you can script everything that you see on the screen is based on script that they execute. No risk. This is a company that is managing risk for companies and changing processes for large companies. And they have they were doing everything on paper before, or Word, but now they have a Pharo web app. So this is the work of Thomas. So this is something with banks and money and and information. Air flowing. I only know what is on the web. So basically, this is to synchronize creative people together. So that's my company. We are doing tools, dedicated tools to manage another web app for reimbursement in Germany. I don't know what they do. They told me, yes, we do Pharo, and this is in the middle. So maybe this is this. I don't know. This one I know. This is a company that is doing, when they have a kind of boxes, they have boxes with labels, and then they put plastic around, and they should recreate the label. So they have scanners, and they can scan the stuff and reproduce it. And they have a kind of component model where they can deploy, basically they can do an application in around 1 hour. So this means that they told me, the client tell us what we want, for example, with big buttons, and they have a kind of data flow system where they can link their components. They can have a component that is a web archive or things like that, and then they place the graphical element and they wrap the stuff and boom, they get the application. So Mr. Bagger is one, and they have another one that I don't remember. This is called Post. So typically in Switzerland, the Post has problem because they told me that they have a lot of mails that are sent to addresses that do not exist or people left, and they get tons of mails that are not delivered, so they have to scan the mail. And this is a software that scans, that they have a kind of system like that that can scan mails and recognize the addresses and manage all this stuff. So that's it. So if you look historically, we started in 2009, and then we are here. There will be a release in April. We try to have one release every year. Our goal, this is that we don't want layers. We try to avoid layers. So we try to rewrite everything when we don't like it. So sometimes this is. So in Pharo 2, we rewrote the file system abstraction. And in fact, it is quite close now. We checked recently, this is quite close from the design of Java and IO. And said, oh, okay, they have the notion of path and things like that. So it's similar to that. We should rewrite, for example, the stream because we want to have a more Lisp-like combination of streams and all kinds of things. So it takes time, but we don't want to stack things on top of. So, of course, not everything is perfect because my dreams are big. But what I like these pictures. This is one guy that sent me that. This is really moving. We have a lot of people that even contribute to Pharo that we never met. That's an important slide. So when I said Pharo is yours, is that this means that if people invest time in fixing, sometimes you know that can be fixing a stupid glitch like I would like this stuff to be selected correctly, or we pay attention that if you submit fixes and they make sense, we integrate them. So in the sense that we don't do Pharo for the ego or whatever. We just do it because, in fact, in our team we like the idea of Pharo and the simplicity and all that stuff. We would like to have another small talk that is doing the same like that. We will just use it, but it does not exist. So we said, okay, we should do it. But we don't do it for ourselves because as a researcher, you know, I could just write a little toys in Scheme and that would be okay for publishing. And it could be even smarter because I could write something that generates the Greek automatically out of the Scheme. And I would even look even smarter than now. So, but we like the engineering part of it. I like the engineering part of it. So, but we pay attention that people can contribute. And that's also the message. So this means that even with 20 minutes per week, you can get an impact. Because we will pay attention. For us, there are no such simple changes that are not worth looking at it. We are systematic. We believe in incremental improvement, and we know that sometimes we have work that takes 2 years to be done, and then we do it in parallel. So, yes, so Pharo, this is really a living system, and then if I program with you after, you will see that in action. Now I will show that to you a bit. So basically we use Inspector, so we have this object that we can discuss with the object, I will show you that. The programs are also objects for us, but we don't have really this distinction. So a program is an object, because a class is an object and a method is an object. It's an object that has compiled methods and things like that. So we are really used to this interaction with living objects. And I want to show you one video. So there was this video, and I want to show you another one. This is a guy that decided, and I like the idea. He said, yes, I want to use Pharo for doing a 3D game engine. And I said, wow. So he's generating OpenCL and connecting to CPUs, and I don't know exactly what he's doing. But I said, yes, I love this idea because if he succeeds, it means that we should have a really good C integration. And I just want to show you 3 minutes. He sent me a video. This is 140 megabytes, so the three first minutes are fun. So what he's doing here, he has the description of the scene, and he has the camera, and I don't know what. And then he's opening an inspector on this scene. And now he has his, I don't know what, this cube with his mirror. And again, he is interactive with it. I don't know what he's doing, in fact. I didn't understand really the video, but I don't care because this is the idea that is behind that interests me. So, typically, for people that are doing Lisp or things like that, that should be normal. But I have a lot of colleagues of mine that are working in C++ for when they do 3D, and they don't have these kinds of feel. And so you see, so what he used the context to be able to change his... And for example, one guy in my team did a backend, the same with a chimpmunk. Chimpmunk, this is a C library for doing physical manipulation. And usually if you write a C program, it runs, boom, and it's finished. And now what he can script the interaction with objects that are bold, that folds, and things like that. Just why we do that, this is just to show to the people that the world does not have to be static. So I will finish after that. So now he's doing exactly the same, but with the... the spotlight. But for me, after, I want to show you something much more interesting, is that we generate code on the fly, and that we use that when we develop. So what I will do, I will show you after, I will show you a bit the syntax and things like that, and then I will show you a video step by step to show to you what we can do in the same way, but with our own program. So you see, so you get the idea, and you can put millions of cubes on the screen, so that's not really interesting after. So after, I will show you this. There was this guy that wanted to script Picasa to display just some picture. And what is interesting is that he's doing it on the fly in a really interesting way. For me, I said, yes, this is something that I cannot write in books, because this video, they are completely live, and I will show you that after. So let's look about the language. So the syntax fit on a postcard. Boom. That's it. That's the syntax. You have all the syntax of Smalltalk on this slide. So basically, I define a method that is expecting an argument. This is a method's comment or a comment. This is an annotation, because we have what we call pragma, which are executable. We can query the system and say, please, system, give me all the methods with this annotation, and we can execute them. Definition of a variable, true, false, nil, messages, 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 all the rest is messages. Lambda expression, the square brackets are lambda expression. So assignment, so self, super, the dot is a separator. This is an array. So we have two kinds of arrays. I just put one. But this is an array. This is a character, a symbol, like in Lisp. We have unique string in the system. So this means that we use those symbols for identity data structure. A string, all kinds of numbers. This is a loop. This is an iterator. So basically, we have the equivalent of for, like in Java, but usually we don't use that, because we have a collection of iterators. We have do, collect, this is map. So we have the map, we have the select, we have the detect, we have all the fold that we want in all kinds of direction. I'm always confused with them, but we have them. And we use, what is nice is that all these operators, they work on nearly all the collection. So we have something like, I don't know, 80, a bit more, maybe more, collections. And all the iterator works the same. So this means that, so this is a lambda with an argument. So here this is each, and the lambda, the body of the lambda. And here the semicolon, this is when I'm lazy, and that basically I always send a message to an object. I send isNil to nil, I send alt to self, name to class. When I'm lazy, that I don't want to repeat transcript, I can put semicolon, like that I have more compact code. And here you have return, and that's it. So that's it. You see? There is nothing left. And this is the same. The syntax fit on one postcard. And I like that, because I'm not a syntactical guy, so that's why I like Lisp or Scheme, and it was enough. So if we look at the language, we have no constructor, we have no static methods, we have no operator, we have no type declaration, no primitive type, no interfaces, no need for factories. We don't need factories like in Java, because class methods, they are late bound. So this means that if I have classes that have methods, I just send, and then this is dynamically resolved, so I can use inheritance to register things, and I don't need factory. We don't have package, private, modifier, whatever. We don't have parameterized type, because we are dynamically typed, so we can put what we want in our collection. We don't have boxing and unboxing. Still, we can do a lot of things. Huh? By the way, a parenthesis. In December, I was visiting a company. This is a company that is doing €6 billion business in the US. And they do the silicium they create microprocessors on silicium. And they told me, oh, you know what? I visited them, you know, with in white and things like that. And what they do is that they develop machines for Samsung, Intel, and things like that. They told me, oh, one of these silicium things can cost up to 1 million euro when this is finished the process. And they have machines that are like that, with pipes everywhere and to dope to. And all these machines, they are driven by a Smalltalk system. Not Pharo, I try to suggest that to them. But the same, the AMD 64-bit factory that is in Germany, this is a Visual Works Smalltalk system that manage all the robots in the company. So when I said that we have only object, often when I said that, people said, yeah, yes, like in Java. No, not like in Java. Like us, you know? So this means that the mouse, the booleans, the array, the number, the strings, windows, scrollbar, canvas, files, trees, compiler, sound, URL, whatever, everything is an object. In fact, there is nothing else. So we cannot express something else than an object. So objects are instances of classes. Huh? So here, I have a point. So I send the message @ to the integer 10 with 200 as argument, and it returns me a point. So that's a point. How do I know that this is a point? I ask the glass, what is your class? It tells me, oh, I am a point. And point, this is an object, because this is a class, but this is an object. And I can say, oh, you know, what are the methods that you implement? Give me the signature, I can send the message selector to the point, and boom, I get all the message not inherited that the class implements. I can say, oh, you know, what are your instance variable names? Because to see what kind of point you are. Okay, so this is the reflective API, like a get field, get whatever. So now the model, public, methods are public. They are all laid bound. The attributes are protected. And there is single inheritance. That's it. So yes, we have traits. And I'm not sure that I like traits or not. So I have a love-hate relationship with traits. Let's say it like that. So I'm not sure that I like them so much. But when we need them for real. But that's it. Huh? So you see, everything is an object, single inheritance, public method, attribute, protected attribute, one single model, class are object two, and we don't have different things. So we don't say, oh yeah, this is a static method, so it should be treated like that. No, a static method is just a method like any other method in the system. It is just defined on a class, while the other one is used for the instances. So basically, this slide is slightly wrong. It should be message plus object plus closure. Because this is really important, we can have the simplicity in the language because we have closure. Without closure, you cannot have a control flow construct in the language. Because for us, if the condition is just a message send, the loop is just a message send because we have closure. So I should change this slide. So just to show you a bit the syntax for the people that are Java oriented, usually people are really afraid. Oh, I don't understand the Smalltalk syntax. I said, come on, don't be old. We identify the stuff that you write. We remove them. We put two because we need to distinguish between this and this argument. And we put colon. So it should be OK. I think that as a computer scientist, we are used to a lot more complex syntax like const **, p, p ampersand, and this is the most complex part of the syntax. So, just to play a bit with the numbers, yes, plus is a message. This is also a message. And two is a number. And this is also an object. This is not a small int or I don't know what. This is an object like any other object in the system. After, those objects are really, really optimized. So this means that in memory, the small integer, they are not object like any other. but you don't care as a programmer. As a virtual machine implementer, you care because you don't have a pointer to the class. The value of the object is the pointer itself and all kinds of implementation issue, but beside that, this is an object. So the syntax of Pharo, you have three kinds of messages, in fact. You have the unary messages, like factorial 5. I send factorial to 5. I send carriage return to transcript. So unary messages, there is no argument. After you have binary messages are all the messages that looks like maths. Slash, slash, backslash, greater than, exclamation mark, tilde, 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 equal, tilde, all this, all the stuff that you cannot really read, this is binary messages. And you have keyword message. So here I can send to 3, are you between 10 and 5? And you said no. Or I can say transcript. So here I have two arguments, but the message is between and I have transcript show that says, okay, I want to display the string hello. And that's it. And of course, we have lambdas. So if I want to express, so what is a lambda in fact? Here, this is a, for us, this is an anonymous method. Because our methods are lambdas. So they can be stored, they can be passed as arguments, they can be generated, even if this is not in the culture. We don't generate a lot of combination of things because we have object for that. So, but we could do that. So if I want to express this function, I will express it like that. So here, I really store the lambda expression into a variable, and here I execute it. So what you see is that if I want to fork a process, I will do fork. Because what a lambda is, and I guess that you know it, but a lambda frees the computation. So this means that when I execute, when I ask the value of this expression, I get a lambda. And then after I do whatever I want, I can set schedule, run, execute now, and all these kinds of things. So you see, so times repeat when you want to have a really silly loop. I should not have to explain to you what is it. This is repeat that. Max, how do we implement max on the class number? If I am smaller than the number, then the max is the number, else this is me. Obviously. But again, this guy here is a message with closure. Here, this is the implementation of these methods, just to show you. So this is the method's name, this is the argument, the comment, return x, I send the message x to the point, and this is use a lazy end, because if this is not the case, I can just discard the computation. And I will use like that. When I want to create a class, that's a message. So I send the message, subclass, variable, instance variable names. It's too long and I would like to shrink it. But we have to educate the Smalltalk people that we can have more compact names. Huh? So here I send this message to the superclass and said, I want to create a class named point with x and y as instance variable. Most of the time, I don't type this stuff because the system does it for me. Because I'm programming and the system tells me, I don't understand this variable. Do you want a local variable or an instance variable? I said an instance variable, and it creates it for me. So that's why usually we never type that. So I just want to have fun a bit with numbers because this is. So just to show you automatic coercion, and normally since you are, at least for me when I was doing Lisp, it was obvious that the world should be like that. It would be like that for you too. But for some people, this is not like that. So here I said, oh, what is the class of small integer? This is of one, this is small integer. Because this is, we have the notion of really small object. Now, I asked, I said, you know, what is the largest number that can fit on a small integer? This is this one. So now if I add one to this, what do I get? So I get what the smallest large positive integer. And that's normal because I had I was over the capacity, so automatically. And we can do all kinds of things like that. So here I just wanted to show to people that we have large numbers. There is no problem. I could saturate my memory of numbers if I want, because so. And when I do a if I do a division with large numbers, I get what I should get and not errors. Because 1000 factorial divided by 99, and there is no magic. It's a really, really, really stupid implementation of factorial. So integer, factorial, if self equals 0, then I return 1. If self is positive, then I return self multiplied by self minus 1 factorial. And then if else, this is not valid. You see? Okay. So what I like for me, and also why this is interesting, this is why I work on Pharo, because I like real problems. Not things that I could think that I could imagine that it would be a problem. No, real problem that we see because we develop daily the system and things like that. And what I like also in particular is that I can learn from the system. And I want to show you a bit these kinds of things. So I will do it live. So in Pharo, I'm just we stole the Eclipse icons because we didn't add good icons. So I'm not sure that they are good either, but I didn't argue too much. So we have packages here and probably too many. So you have a package, and here you have the class with the inheritance, and then we have what we call protocol or method category to sort a bit the methods when the class to find our way. And here you have a method and the method definition here. So you can find information like that, but this is not fun. So do you see, or should I change the fonts? It's okay. So there is a tool that I really like that is called the Finder. So in Pharo 4, by the way, I should say that in Pharo 4, if I press Shift Enter, I have a tool that is called Spotter, and then I can type any name I want, like menu morph, and then I can jump directly. And I can navigate. I am trying to learn the tool because it's not developed by us. So I never know the key combination, and you can navigate in the system with that. So this is, we have a group that is working on the brand new tool for Pharo, and we are really happy that they do that, because like that we can concentrate on something else. But the Finder, so the Finder, this is this tool. So here I can type, for example, print. And since this is written selector, I get all the methods in the system that contain prints. When you see a little, you see that you have different methods, and then I see the definition below. So far, not really exciting, but useful. Now you can do the same with class. You can say, oh yes, class. All the class that contain print. But there is something for me that is much more interesting. This is example. So example, what is it? Is that I can give, you know, usually I know what I want, but I don't know how to express it. So I said, for example, 11, 2, and I should get 5. And the system tell me, oh yes, this is, I don't even know, this is slash slash or backslash backslash. I don't know, I'm dyslexic, so you know. For me, this is the same. So I give the argument of the message, the result, and I ask the system, find it to me, please. Is there one that works? And I can see after, oh yes, this has been implemented on all these classes, this slash slash. And when I have a star in front, it means that it's the one that returned true to my system. So you see the difference now if I said, no, in fact, this was not 5 that I want, but 5.5. If you tell me, oh, this is division. And I like that because there are all kinds, the library is quite dense. So what I was showing yesterday to the students during the lecture is that you know what is to concatenate. I should have my glasses, A, B, C, D. So you know what you want. Said, oh, if I have two strings, I want the concatenation. Now, if you don't know, this is not obvious that you will find that this is comma. And comma is implemented. You can concatenate all kinds of things in the system, like sound, normally. Sound is not loaded. And you have collection and collection. And what I like is that this, is that when you have an example like that, you can select it. So I go slowly. Get my evaluator. In fact, everywhere I type code, I have an evaluator. Often people said, yes, where is the REPL in Pharo? This is everywhere. This is not a REPL. This is something that you can execute code anywhere you want. So here I said, please execute the code and show me the result. And I get the result. I could say, oh, please execute the code and give me an object that I can interact with this guy. So here I can browse, ah, yeah, this is this class. And now I can say, okay, give me the first element. Ah, the first element is 2, okay. And I can navigate into the structure of the object. So we have a new inspector, so this means a new way to navigate inside object and find and interact with them. If you are interested, there is a really good presentation by Tudor Girba. So this is, for this part of Pharo, we don't do it. This is a team at Bern that is doing that. So you see, you can, for example, if you want to say, okay, can I find a match? I will say true. Star, I never know. So I should say A, B. Does it work? Yes. So the system tells me, okay. And match looks like the one I want. And it is implemented on string. Okay, then on strings. So I get that you got the ID. So that plus the fact that you have all the code that you see and all the code of the system. For me, this is interesting because what I can also do, I can put also a breakpoint everywhere. And I can get a debugger, and I can interact with it. So I would like to show you now the video. And we will do it slowly because... No. DLC, please. So we often say that we code in a debugger. What does it mean? So this is a bit fast, so I have to pay attention. So this guy basically found a URL, a query on Picada to get some whatever, some information. Now he's turning that into a URL. He got an error, now he get. So now he get a stream of what he got from the web. So this is not interesting. He's loading a package to parse XML. Okay, boom, good. So now what he has, he is building a document tree. So this means that here, in this variable, he has this XML tree. And now he wants to explore the tree. So what he's using this. Navigation things where I can pass a lambda. And what is interesting is that he put a alt inside the system. So this means that he does not know what he wants to do, he just wants to get inside on the node. And now he's opening a debugger. And that's interesting because this means that this, whoops, I forgot to. I won't wait. Where is my cursor? Yes, here. What is interesting is that this variable is bound. And it is bound to one element of the tree. In fact, the first one that match entry. And this guy is a living object. So this means that now I will start to be able to interact with this object. And this is what he's doing. So you see, he asked to get, I want to have an inspector. And this inspector let me get inside my structure. And now he's looking for, okay. Ah, too fast. Wait, I repeat it. Ah. So let's repeat it. And I will stop it. The debugger, in fact, is the best place to have context. You see here, he's interacting with this object, with this element of the tree, tweaking it, having these kinds of conversation with a living object, and said, oh, yes, this is character data. So now he knows, oh, yes, I got this content. OK, this is the content. So now he closed the, he's closing the debugger, while usually I would continue because I don't do it. He's doing it from the workspace. I do it from a method. I start with a method that is completely empty. And I code in the debugger up until it is working. And I just said, proceed or close the debugger. I don't care. Because now he has to copy and paste. But this is because he started with to work in a file. I never work in a file. I work directly in a method like that. I don't have to do copy and paste or whatever. So now this is interesting because what he wants to do, he wants to have a collection for the title and the picture. So he's creating a collection. So here he created a collection and he said, yes, I will put my photo in this collection. This is what he's doing here. And here I should go really pay attention. So why this is red? So here he's saying, oh, you know, I want to create a Picasa photo. So he should put parentheses. I want to create a Picasa photo with the title that I extracted. In fact, he does not need this stuff. He could put it directly here, but anyway. And a photo. The class is not defined. These methods are not defined. And the system will create them automatically. You will see. I will try to follow carefully. Put parentheses, if I remember. OK. So you see what the system is showing to me. It said, I don't understand what is Picasa photo because you never define it. There is already a method in the system that is called title. So this is probably not this one, but it does not guess. And this one does not exist. So said, OK. The guy will still execute it. And what the system asked, he said, yes, you know, you use a variable that has never been defined. So what do we do with that? And in that case, you said, yeah, define a class. Please, I want to define a class. So you have a pop-up. Well, you define a class. And then the program continues to execute now that the class has been defined. And so this is the same for URL. So now, during the execution, What's happened is that, of course, this method does not exist. So there is an exception and said, sorry, guys, we don't understand this method's title. So we have this button create. So it creates a method. So it created a method. Normally, it should ask in which class. OK, yes. And it went fast. So I have to explain. So the system created a method that raised an error. That because it said, OK, I compile a method for you. OK, no problem. The program is relaunched to continue the flow of execution. And then, of course, there is no magic. I have to implement this one. So this is what he's doing. Now he will say, oh, yes, title. He's recompiling the method. And the system said, yeah, but I don't know the title method that you define. Said, yes, I know. Define an instance variable. So the class is recompiled on the fly. And now it has an instance variable. Now we have the methods. And now we can assign to it. And we said, proceed. This means continue. Please continue. It will be the same for photo URL. So the methods are created on the fly. Same idea, huh? Create an instance. So now he's a bit smarter because he said, I don't want to store a string. I want to store an object. Good. And now this means that basically, when he inspects that, he gets this Picasa photo object. And he can interact with them. This is an alternative inspector. So you see here that URL photo was not defined. So here the system is, I thought, sometimes it's a bit smarter. Sometimes it guesses the instance variable that we want. Ah, yes. So now you want to display, you want to get a bitmap out of the stream. And he's just looking, OK, this is the wrong, it should be binary, OK, so. And you get the object. So now what he said, OK, I have this nice expression here. I want to turn it into a method in the object because I want to have for all my photo, I want to get the picture. So he just sent a message. The system said, sorry, I don't know this message. And then he will paste directly the expression, boom. And now we can ask that to any object because the method is there. And I don't, yes. So I will let it go, but after this is the same. It just want to build the user interface to have the feel. Okay, so I will not comment, and this is the same principle, except that here this is. You should know the interface. What I like with this video is that it captures well the interactivity that we have when we program with the system. You know, we don't think in terms of files, of I don't know what. We generate that. After, we can version everything in all kinds of versioning systems and things like that. But when we are developing, we have this debugger. Usually, people are afraid by the debugger. They said, oh, I should close it. If you look at students when they have a debugger, the first reflex is to close it. And this is the most, our best friends, in fact. So there was one method missing because you never invoked it. And then, yeah. Wonderful. What else? Poop. OK, so you see, so I like this video because this guy did that. And I said, oh, yes, it's really capture. It's extreme. We are not always programming like that. But we know that we can do it. So, and this can be for with anything. So this means that it could be a POP connection where you retrieve mails if you want, or a web service, or that's the same. because for us they are objects. Okay, so where is my presentation? Yes, something that I wanted to show you, since you are programmers. So, by the way, this is a really good comics. Huh? It's from Mignola, the guy that is doing the guy with the red hand. Okay, Hellboy. So yes, he saved me. But anyway, I want to hide the slide because I have one question for you. And this is a question that I ask students. And for me, this is a question that is really important. And I ask people, I said, and this is also about learnability because I learned Smalltalk alone. Basically, when I was a master student, I knew something like 17 different languages, but not Smalltalk. So, and then when I was at Bern, I realized that I had a sensation, so I could steal the small talk that of the University of Nice and play with it. And then after we bought it, but I learned a lot. And I was browsing the system because what I like is that I could go completely inside. And then I realized how once I discovered how the not message is implemented. And I was shocked. And I would like to know, you are probably object-oriented programmers or you program one day with that. How you would implement not. So if you know it because you read it, you don't say it, but so how do you implement not? Nobody has an idea? Even a bad one. So usually when I start a lecture, I asked this question and I said to the student, I was giving a lecture 2 days ago, and I start with that and I said, okay, how do we implement not? Of course, since people will said, come on, I don't care about Booleans, what this guy is telling me, I don't care. I ask three questions. I ask, how do you implement not? How do you implement if true, if false, or? And why do I ask this silly question? And I said, you know, the third question is the most important one. So I will show you how not is implemented, because for me, when I saw that, it convinced me that this is a cool language. So not is implemented like that. We have three classes, Boolean, false, and true. And not, typically, the not implemented on false return true. And the not implementing on true return false. Huh? Logically. And the funny thing is that in the first version of Pharo, XOR was implemented here in the superclass. And so Boolean is abstract, using I don't remember what for XOR, I never remember. And one guy came and said, guys, you know, you can gain factor 2 just on XOR because you have to define XOR in the subclass. So this means that even this design, you can also get fast. But what is really important is that for me, this is the essence of object-oriented programming. This is the essence of dispatch. This means that if you understand that when you send a message, you dispatch, because usually you are a smart student, what you do, first question with not, you write a if. If, blah, 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 byte, I don't know what. And then normally, since I'm a vicious guy, the second question is how do you implement if? And you can implement if, but we don't want to have if that is recursive. And then he said, no, we don't need if. There is no if. And for me, when I saw that, I said, yes, I love that. And I can read it. I can go inside and dive into the system. That's what I learned by also having a system that is simple. Because when you think about it, with this one-page syntax, you can read everything from semaphore to compiler going to vector graphics. So this is cool. So you see, so OR. The implementation of OR is wonderful. OR, this is pipe. On false, this is Boolean. And on true, this is self. Because that should be like that. And I like that. So now what I can do is that I was thinking that we could hack something together or not. So what I wanted to hack with you that. So I don't know if you play this is in French. Dungeons & Dragons. But when I played Dungeons & Dragons, our books were full of that. Huh? So, and since you are a bit geek, probably you know. And this is plain Smalltalk syntax. Huh? Because I can extend, because this is something that I forgot to tell you that is really cool, is that I can add a method and I can package these methods in a class that is not in the package. So this means that I can build two layers. So like that, when I have my role-playing system, I will just define the methods D20 on the class integer. So if you want, we can code that. I see it somewhere, and then it's the exercise is approximately half an hour. Okay, we do that? You should help me, huh? Ah, I didn't revise. I was sleeping this afternoon because I said else I will die during this presentation. So, okay. We do it test first, maybe. Or we do some agile kind of development. Huh? So the first thing that we need a package. Add package. Nice. Ah, okay, so I should change the image. Okay, no, I will throw away the package. I loaded the code. And I don't want this guy in my system. Poof, gone. Let's save that. By the way, in Pharo, I will not make it on purpose but everything that you type is logged. So there is a tape, which is really nice because you know when you give a lecture, the students for the exercise, they said, oh, I lost my code. No, in fact, they did nothing. You can open the tape. Usually I tell them, you know, there is a system that logs everything you do so that you can recover in case of a crash or I don't know, even you forgot to save the system. You can never lose your changes or your program. And some of them, they don't understand that, so they still tell you cracks. So let's add a package. Oh, shit. Dice. Okay. So, you know, the first thing that I would like to be able to express something like that. Let's start to have, I would like to be able to express D20. Not syntactically for the moment. I just want to have, we start with one dice, and then after we will have a handle of dice. So one dice. So here I compile the methods, the class. So I could, if I want, open an inspector, but this object has nothing. So what do we do with that? We want to roll, so we can write, let's write a test like that, we will see. Test case. Okay, I have my test. So now let's write something stupid as so should not dice new raise error. So Okay, I have a green test.
Ooh, cool.
So, default faces, for example, so I can say self-assert face dice, sorry, dice new faces equal 6. Why not? So this one will be red. So I can create faces, for example. Yes, accessing. Okay. Yes. Return faces. Instance variable. Yes. So now I can select this guy, and of course it will return me nil because it is not initialized. So I said, yeah, okay, that would be good. Let's create an initialize method. Initialize. So initialize, this is a method that is always invoked when we send a message new. So if we are disciplined, we do that. Faces equals 6. And then now if I run my test, it is green. So we save. So now I want to roll a dice. So let's write a test. Roll 100 times repeat. It's a bit difficult to test something that is random, so but we will see. So we should say the dice new self assert the roll between, yeah, between and 2 6. No, we can do better. We can do dice faces. And why this is red? Ah, yes, this is red. I made something wrong. Yes, between and. Yes. So it does not work, obviously. So we don't have to code all the time in the debugger. You know? But this is fun. So yeah, I should implement role. Role. Ah, yeah, something that is really confusing for people that start Smalltalk is that you see what I'm doing. Sometimes I'm just hacking in the system and people think, oh yes, he's modifying his code. No, each time the system is very strange, but each time I type something that is new, it just defines a new method. So like that. So we don't care of changing the code, we don't lose it. But I realize that yes, this can be really confusing. So normally I know that there is a method at random. So I can query the system. So this means that I can do, no, we remove the shortcut, so this is obvious. So we have POM M, which is give me all the implementers, and POM N, which is give me all the senders of this method in the system. And we can navigate to get example. So here I said, okay, I know that there is at random, but I don't know if it starts at 0 or at 1. I never know. So at random on integer, answer an integer from 1 to self. Okay, excellent. That's what I want. And I run my test. They are green. Good. So I will categorize a bit because I don't like when this is messy. Up. By the way, if you want to have fun and to redo these little language exercises, there is a video on my website, step by step, and you have also the PDF that you can do. You have the PDF with the solution and the PDF without the solution. So usually when people want to start to learn Smalltalk, I give them that and then they. In 1 hour, normally they survive. So you see now, if I get this little guy, I can send faces. 6, okay. We have a problem with the fonts. So now what I would like to change this representation because I would like to know the number of my dice. So there is the equivalent of two strings in Pharo, and I want to do it because like that it will help us after. So I do super print on a stream. We have all kinds of way to do that, but I take the simplest one or the one that I remember. Faces print string. And here maybe I can put some space. I concatenate the strings. And then now if I, you see, I get a dice 6 like that when we will have the. Okay, so now we need multiple dice. So let's do, we will define a class, dice handle. I think that it should hold dice. Dice is a very strange English name. It's plural, it's everything. So, at least for me, French, this is really difficult. This guy is difficult. So here I know I want to have a collection of, I want to have a collection, so I will just initialize it. There is no need. Dice. Okay, so what do we do with that guy? We will add, yes, let's write a test. So let's write a test. We will write test add so we have a handle. Self assert dice. Let's do it. Number of dice is 0. H add dice new faces. We don't have faces, but we should be able to have faces. We don't care for the moment. Okay, we add this guy and then we want to check that we have one. A temp. Okay, of course, does not know that. So here I can define add a dice, this is dice, add a dice. And what did I say? I said that this is number of dice, this is what? This is dice size. Something like that. Yes. And two times. So, oops, I want to make sure that that this is not a set. Okay. So we have, so now we can express, we can express that we have two dice of 6. That's cool, so we could express either roll on it. I would like to add methods for creating better creation. So I don't want to write new, I want to write faces 200, and I want to write something like that because self assert could be better. D20 faces equal 20. Okay, good. That's wrong. Okay, so this guy will not work, obviously. So faces, this is easy. Ah yes, I could have done so. I could have shown you that the system is able to generate methods that are well formed. Normally, if I should have said create, he would have created this one because this is so obvious that it created them for me. Okay, and now what I want to show you, this is I want to have a class method, because if we look here, I send this message faces to the class, not to an object. So how do I do that? I go on the class side. So this is basically the static world for Java, but for us this is just a message. And I will set faces, so a number. I will do self new faces a number, and if I'm clean I will do yourself. So what I will explain, this line is equivalent to write something like that. This line is equivalent to write something like inst self new. So self is the class, by the way, on this side. Inst faces a number, return inst. Because yourself is a message that is doing what, by the way? Oh, yourself returns self. So it said, ah, yes. So what you should see is that this self is the class. Because in Smalltalk, there is only one model. When I send a message to an instance, I go to the class and I look for the methods. So when I send a message to a die, I go to the class and I look for the methods. When I send a message to the class itself, I go to the class of the class. So, and this is this button that let me go there. But we have two different classes in the system that are represented by two objects. As a programmer, we don't care, but the kernel is completely described in itself and consistent from that perspective. Instance creation, so we are a bit clean. Okay, so now normally my test is green, yes. Okay, so we can, let's roll a dice for the handle. So what is it? Roll. So I will do what? So I can do it in a functional way, you know, like this, I never remember. Or I can do it in the bad way. So I will do it in the bad way, like that. We can do it in the right way after. So I can set res, res equals 0, let's do a loop, dice do each res equal each roll, because I want to take all the die and roll them, plus res. Let's write a test for that. So let's take this guy, roll, we create a handle, blah, 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 we put 2d6 inside, and then we check that we do roll, and it should be between 2, I guess. Between 2 and 12. something like that, probably. And we do that 100 times because this is fun. Huh? Why not? Ah, no, it's green. Okay. We could have written that as dice inject 0, because this is the neutral operation, into accumulator. You know, you know when you have accumulator and each, and write sum equal each role plus sum. But for me, I prefer to put it as a comment because I go much faster to read that than to read the other one, because the problem with lambda expression is that we don't have names. So this means that inject into, I never remember, and I'm dyslexic a bit, so I never remember if the first one is the accumulator or the stuff. So the time that I look for it, I have written that, and that's okay. But we have all these enumerators that are there. So now, what is left to do for us? Two things. We should take two handles and add them. And we should make sure that we have the right syntax. So let's define plus. So what do? We create, we will do it the functional way, because this is not fun to mutate the receiver. I would say that this is bad style. Typically, the point, the rectangle in Pharo, they are all functional from that perspective. You have two places where you can modify it, and all the rest of the library is creating object. So we will create a new handle. So new handle. Dice handle new. With self, we've said dice. Do, maybe we can do it in different way. I have a student that did this one in one, it just said sum, but what we do is that new handle, we should have written a test first, but okay. Each, and I will, it's annoying. Yes, please. Okay, all this red. And now I should do another handle, the same. Book. And I return new handle. So I imagine, I don't know if I define, it will not work because I didn't define a dice here. So let's add dice. Return dice, and let's write a test, because I should have started from that. So I have this guy that has, and now I want to have another one, H2, we are nearly there, you know. Face is 20. Up, and I want to say H3 equal H plus H2, and H3 number of dice 3. Temp. Why add? Repeat. Yes, I added to the first one. Good. Okay. And then I can verify this guy. So if I put a self alt here, when I execute my test, I get my debugger. And here I could see that H3 this is a collection of I have two dice of 6 and one of 20. Okay, so we have the addition. So now what is left? This is, I want to have the syntax, I want to create dice in a much more elegant way. So what we can do is that we will browse integer. So this is an integer, yes, an integer. What I will do, I will add a protocol that is called star dice. This means what I'm saying, I said, please, this method is added to integer, but when we package it and we save it, I want that this is saved with the package that I created. Ah, okay, they are already there, dice handle, So let's remove them. That's a bug, because I didn't do unload, I just said remove. So what would be D20? That should be something like dice. No, this is wrong. I was thinking that this is like that. No. This is, I should create a handle. Yes. I should create a new handle because I want to have N. I want to have self, so self times repeat. Yes, I want to have self time repeat. I don't have my glasses, yes. Dice faces 20. Is it correct? Yes, it's incorrect. H add would be better. And? Yes, I'm tired, you know. We see it, obviously. Dice handle, yes. Okay, now it should work. So now if I type something like 3D20, inspect, I get my 320 dice. So we can imagine that we can do that really fast for others. So the best thing is to do n, and here we will pass n. And based on that, we can re-express this guy. We can say, self D20, and now we can say D4, D2, that's more a coin, huh? But and D6. And now what I should be able to do, I should be able to do what I wanted, so 3D20 plus 2D4, roll 38, yeah, kind of work. So you see, so we develop our little games interactively, and I show you that we can extend the system and things like that. So that was the little exercise that I wanted to do with you. So if you have questions, I can answer. We have our own versioning system, so we can version in what we call Monticello on this repository. Some people use GitHub. So in the future, we will support GitHub natively. For now, we don't. Because we want to protect the poor students that are learning Pharo to be master in GitHub or in Git. So we need some engineering to be done. So yes, I did that. So what I wanted to, what I could show you, because I stole some slides. So what I have some slide about what we are currently doing, why the future is bright. And I could show you a bit server side, what the people were doing with server side web application, because this is what the companies are usually doing when they do Pharo. So I can do that in, just to give you an idea, in quarter of an hour, if you want. So I don't know where I put the stuff. Let's check. Yeah. So is it working? Localhost. Okay, this is working. Yeah. So basically, if we look, we have a C-side that is, and I will show you C-side. That is, you can use C-side for doing web application, complex web application, like what this company is doing, where they have scheduling and things like that. You see, you can do a lot of REST also with C-side. With just simple annotation, you can develop REST service really fast. You have Zinc. Zinc, this is a HTTP server that a guy restarted from scratch following the spec because he was fed up by the other one, and I really like that. And they use that in production every day. And the last time I asked him, I said, okay, your server, is Pharo stable? He told me we have an uptime of 240 days. So this is 8 months before crashing, so this is nice. And on a server that is used. And other things. So Reef, this is an extension of C-side that encapsulates JavaScript, because in C-side, I will not show you how to do that. There is a book on the web that I wrote and that explains everything, where you have different ways to inject C-side into your web application. What Reef is doing, and we should have the documentation soon, it's to propose components that embed the JavaScript. So like that, and you can control also if you do some client or server computation. And then after, you have all kinds of, and for the database also. So we are doing an effort because the database, this is a bit the mess. So I guess that during the next 6 months, we will clarify all this stuff, because we have people that need that. So, and there is also Ember, so you can, some people, they develop the client side in Ember and the server side in Pharo, and you have a nice way to communicate between the two. So C-side. So I want to start with the demo. So I will do 5 stupid examples. And the fifth one is the most important one. So let's start with a stupid example. This is adder. Yes, adder. So how do I do that in C-side? I add two numbers and I print the result. I told you this is a challenge. So basically this is an old version of C-side because I didn't load it the latest version. You have a kind of component. This is a class, the adder, and what you have one method here. And then after I will show you how this guy is implemented, because again, you can navigate inside. So you define two local variables, you request for the first number, you request for the second number, and then you display the result because you turn the number into something. Okay? What is interesting is that what's happened if I am a distracted programmer, you know? So I recompile my web app. Where is my browser? Here, okay, let's do that like that. So if I restart, loop. Oh, that's the stack. So now what I can do, if I press this button, I can get the debugger on the server. Oh, that's the debugger, my best friend. And then the debugger told me, oh, yes, you have a division by zero here. Ah, yes, indeed, I was distracted. So I recompile, proceed, and my web app continues. Of course, my web app is so stupid that this is one method. So if that would be a complex one, you would just restart the one where you put the alt, and obviously all the rest will continue to work. Okay? So that was the first wonderful example that I have. So what else? Ah yes, I have the counter. Is it working? You see? Let's redo it slowly. Because you are tired, I am tired. So maybe you didn't see my joke. So I have special jokes. Down? Okay. So I have my counter, and then we will look at the code, because the code is really challenging, you will see. So I add, when I press, I add by two. And I press this wonderful back button. You know? So I press the back button. So what I am doing, in fact, I'm desynchronizing the server from the web browser. And now what's happened if I press plus, plus? How much do I get? So if you are a well-trained PHP programmer, you will tell me that this is 20, I don't know what. But since I'm a bit stupid Smalltalk programmer, I will not believe you. You know? So, and how this is done? Let's look at that. Where is this code? VA, I don't remember, counter, they change the name. VA example. Ah. I don't know. So let's look at the tools. So the tools, I will show you that C-site is rendering XHTML by default. So here I see my little component. So when I am development mode, I can access my, to my component. Here I could see the class. Okay, this is VI counter. Okay. So here I can see the code. We will do it in the browser because I prefer. What I can also do is that here I can do something like 20 factorial count. So now I have a large counter, you know. So basically what I did, I went from my user interface to my model because I could navigate. Of course, here my model is a bit limited. This is just a counter. But I can navigate my domain, interact with them, the same way a bit with the inspector that I have in the image, to tweak and to get information out of that. Or I can put a self-alt, and you have another button here, this is stupid, this is for you, you can tweak CSS if you really want. I would say don't do it. So this is VI counter. So let's look at VI counter. Ah, okay. This is the super class that changed. So VA counter, this is the superclass is VA example component because they are automatically registered and things like that. This class has just one instance variable, count. It has one getter, one setter, decrease, increase. Let's put it plus one, that would be nice. When I initialize, I put count to zero because this is a counter. And how do I display the counter? I just said, oh, you know, I would like to have a big number. So I put heading, anchor. So basically, C-site is the framework. So when my component is scheduled and rendered, this method is invoked. And I get a kind of brush that emits XHTML. I don't myself tweak the HTML. So I will say I want an anchor with a callback, which is a closure, of course, with plus plus space, a callback that call this guy. Okay? And now the trick to handle the back button, this is this method, this is the state. So the state is a method that will make sure that it keeps, I don't know how it works because I never really went deep inside this implementation, but this is the place where I would say I want that you keep this synchronized with the view, so that you know, and then that copy the state. So the proof that I can do is that if I remove this method, yeah, this is like that. If I remove this method and if I restart my counter, I will get the normal PHP behavior where I get 10. Okay? So two other stupid examples, bloop. Example two. So example two, how do I do that? Say hello, hello, French, hello, bonjour. So I don't know where they are here. So this guy is a component. It has a Boolean to mention the language. In English, put it to true, French to false. We start with English to false, for example. And here, what I wanted to show you is that, so I have a button. From the callback, I can access the state of the object, the component. From the callback, I can also send a message, that's normal. And here, I have this logic, but this logic, this is anything special. You know, I can take that, extract it, say self foo, okay, foo, hoop, and my app continues to work. So for me, this is, I've write my code like it is normal. So the example three is completely, it's even more stupid. This is how do we do input? Whoop. Okay, if I said Steph, say hello, hi Steph. So how do I do that? I do that like that. I have a text input, and then now I have a lambda with an argument. That's it. Huh? And then I can store the value of the lambda into an instance variable, and from the button I can access this instance variable. So the example four. The example four is more interesting. So this is that, how do I reuse this component? How do I put them all into a page? Because this is what I want. I want reuse. So, and they should work. I have two times the same, and how do I do that? So example four, this is a component, it has children. Now the framework forces me to have a getter and a setter. The render content on. Here I just said, okay, self children do, separated by, this is one of our iterators. And I said, I want to render each and put a break in the middle because I just wanted to have them like that. So you see, there is not that much of a magic. And the initialize methods, I needed the component from somewhere, so I just created them, but you could create them from, so I can add another counter because this is cool. So I can set counter new, another one, and then when I refresh my page, boom, I have two counters, and then we can see if we turn the allows, that I have two counters, and I could browse probably one here. Ah, no, I thought that they were. So, and I can see the code rendered here and activate that. So in essence, this is C-side. So, I took the slides of the guy that maintained and improved C-side during two, three years, and then after he went to Google and disappeared. That's like that. Huh? Before this was Microsoft, now this is Google. Huh? So, okay. Anyway. So I took his slide, so he's a bit provocative, but this is fun. So he said, okay, you know, in PHP, you have these kinds of stuff, and you have to know the rest of the computation. So in fact, this is a bit like a go-to in COBOL. And if you know where you will have to go, then you cannot reuse, because you cannot take this functionality and reuse that back. So there is one interesting article from Avi Bryant, the guy that invented C-side, that he wrote an article that was called HTTP considered harmful to reference to the paper of Distra on COBOL. And so what did he say? Yes, indeed, we don't do that. That neither. So that's a bit aggressive. And what I want to show you, I want to show you the request after. So we saw that. Well, okay, that's what I didn't show you in this example, and then I will show you that now. So basically, what C-side is doing is that on a stateless protocol, it is reintroducing the return of functions that we give as granted. So imagine I have a component A that is scheduled, and I can have other components on my screen, we don't care. If inside the code of somewhere I have A that calls the component B, what will happen is that B is a scheduled modal. So this means that B will take all the events and the rest continue to work. Now, if at some point in time, in a button or in a submit form, you have answer, then B will be unscheduled. And the PC, what it means with this slide, is that the program pointer will just be after the call. So this means that he reintroduces a procedural invocation on top of HTTP. That's basically the trick of C-side, this is that. So I told you, so now if we want to look how this is implemented, because that's what I wanted to, I was curious, I said yes, how nform is implemented. So what was that? Request, request, implementer. So you see I have VA component implementer, that looks like something. So I don't know what they said, but they said request on answer. Request on answer is doing self default on answer, which is doing okay. Yes, we arrived there. So what you see here is that what this request method at the end is doing, it is creating a component via input dialog, which has a message with default things and on answer to do what to do when the guy answers. And now, if we browse the code of VA input dialog, somewhere there should be answer. So let's look at that. Default, label, we don't care. Render content on. Okay, the default action is to answer the value. So this means that here, this is where the loops is closed. When you type enter, you get this call and answer. So this call and answer, this is really the way to reintroduce this, the way we think we program. So what you see is that in C-side, I didn't pronounce the name, pronounce pages. We don't think in terms of page. We think in terms of application and component and stateful. So the XHTML usually is valid. Some people extended the brush to generate SVG because they needed SVG. At some point, they were this, I don't remember, WPA or I don't know what kind of format that they wanted to have. Yes, we don't care, blah, 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 development. Oh, okay, yes, this was a short. So there is a full book with 300 pages on C-side on the web. You can read it. It is open. Not, it's not open source, but you can. It's available. And I just wanted to show you that because many of the companies that are doing Pharo, they are doing web dev, and they are extended either C-side. So usually, and Thomas did that, you don't write C-side code to generate components for forms. Because you have objects, you describe them, and you said, please, dear object, can you behave as a component, and you get a C-side component. So I didn't show you that. This is called Magritte. And you have all kinds of things on top of that. So now I wanted to tell you just three slides on what we are doing, because Thomas gave me a long list of questions. And then after, you ask me anything you want, and I will tell you if I know or not. So we are working on a bootstrap. So Pharo, The size of Pharo right now, maybe this is 16, 20 megabytes when we ship it with all the code. And what we want to have a bootstrap. So we have a bootstrap. So this means that we have the code of the kernel that is in, I don't know, in Git somewhere, and then we can rebuild it. And what we can do, this is fun, we did some experiment, we can do hyper-specialized systems in 11K. So this means that we can have an image. So for us, an image, this is what? This is a memory dump. We take the memory, so the execution model of Pharo, this is bytecodes like in Java, and then we generate assembly code on the fly, blah, 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 blah. But what we have the notion of images. So this means that we can snapshot the system with all the objects, the class, the compile methods, everything, and then we can give that to you and you reopen it because the pointer of program is stored somewhere. And what is nice is that we can generate images that are 11K. They don't do much. For example, this one is just doing the addition of two numbers, but the complete kernel is there. So class inherit from object, class is instance of itself, blah, 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 all these kinds of things. So we will put that in production one of these days because, you know, it should work, it should not impact companies, all the stuff. So this is working since a year, but before it's real. So now what we have in Pharo 4, we have first class variable. And that's really cool because I am a guy that comes from Silos and I know what is it. And I always wanted to have that because in Smalltalk, the variables are strings and he said, shit, that's a string. I want a real object. What can we do with that? We can do really cool stuff. We can do last 2 days ago, there was a guy that said, oh, I wanted to play with slot and I implemented relation, association, bidirectional or, you know, update this part when this one is added, all these kinds of things. And people at Bern, they have a kind of component model for building user interface. And this component model is a data flow. So it's reactive. And what they did is that they extended, they started to have first class reference that behave as data flow and said, yes. So it's really interesting. We dream about that since 5 years and now we have that, so this is cool. This is based on, we have an open compiler. So, because the point is that we want to do that as fast as possible. Huh? So this means that you can specify the bytecode that you want to emit. And after this is a wrap with the variable and you can ship it without the compiler, so all kinds of things like that. So we try to make it well and real. So we are working on a package catalog because we don't know. Because we have one problem is that if you write an XML parser, but you are not a very good programmer, and my friends want to have an XML parser and load your bad code, and your code does not work, you will say, oh, Pharo is bad. He said, come on, this idiot, he code like hell. But nobody knows it. So we want to, this is 3 years that I am trying to get in RIA to pay me an engineer. I want to work on a distribution certification where we run the tests, we run the validation rules, we introduce the, every package can declare the false positive for the rules and things like that because we want to have, we want to certify the packages. And we want a catalog so where we can find information because right now that's not working well. We are working on Git. The problem is that we don't want to expose people to Git assembly because I think that Git, in Git you have two things, you have the good and the bad. And we just want the good. We don't want like these things like why should I go to Stack Overflow to manage a simple distributed versioning system. Pharo has a distributed versioning system. We just miss branches. But beside that, we can say merge, pull, request. We don't do pull request, but we would like to protect also our end users to be able to be fluent in Git. We are working on OS window. So OS window, this is the idea that we want to be able to control all the OS on all the OS objects like window event on all the platform. And we are starting to use SDL. And what is interesting is that all this code was done in the virtual machine in C, and now all this code is in Smalltalk, available for us. So this means that we can maintain it. And we don't have to be C expert to write that. So So for example, we have a company that wants to have multi-touch support. So again, we don't want to be expert in multi-touch, but what we want to make sure is that we have an infrastructure so that people can do multi-touch. In France, there is a group that is doing the prototype for the radar for the army. And they designed the next generation radar software, and they do that in Smalltalk. And they told us, we want to have multi-touch because they can zoom on the map and all these kinds of things. We work on full, so we have, normally, Pharo, what you show is a pixel oriented. And now we have a new canvas that is fully vector graphics. The problem is that we have to rewrite all the widgets, and this is coming. So this means that the new generation, we will have a complete environment that is vector graphic with different backends. One backend is Cairo, and then we will see in the future what we can get. And that's interesting. So, and the good thing is that for the virtual machine, right now, Pharo is using a really old garbage collector and a really old object representation that I think dates from the 16-bit representation of object. So Spur, this is developed by Elliot Miranda at Cadence. He's doing that for Squeak and for Newspeak and for Pharo. It's a new memory manager. So some of the bench, when you take really optimized code, you get a factor 0.5 to 1. When you take normal code, they got factor up to 4. So this is cool. What is interesting is that we have support for ephemerons. So this is clever weak structure, let's say it like that. Pine object, so this means that we can say this object should not move in memory. It's useful when you do FFI call. And support for fragmented memory, because right now, you have to have a block of memory and Pharo take it and run with it. So this means that if you don't, you cannot. And support for 64 bits. So we know that this is painful. We live with that every day. So that should arrive in July. And then we have Sista. So Sista, this is one of our engineers, a really smart guy, that is doing the next level JIT. So normally in modern JIT, you have 4 levels. And in Pharo, what the JIT is doing, so for the moment, this is naive. This is, if the method is okay, I generate assembly code because it is invoked a lot. That's it. What Sista is doing, it is doing a lot more. It is folding, closures, doing constant propagation and all these kinds of things. And without breaking our lovely debugger. Because this means that if I take 2 methods and I just merge them into 1, when I debug that, I don't want to know what you did with my code. So, and we will work, so FFI, the current situation with FFI is that this is the mess. We have different versions and I want only to see 1 that works well instead of 3 that do not work well. So we know this is for this year, we want to have 1 FFI because right now we have 1 that generates assembly code, 1 that is used on C, 1 that is threaded, and we want everything under 1 umbrella with different backends so that we can get free. And I guess that's it.